Hey everybody, it's GauntletX, and welcome back to our final quick draft of Wilds of Eldraine for this return trip. Without further ado, let's start off with our excellent Pack 1 Pick 1 Rare. We've got the Goose Mother here, a completely absurd card. She's going to be great at any mana cost, basically, for 3 or more. At 3 mana, you're getting a 3-3 flyer and a food token, and when you attack, you can sack that food token to draw a card. So tons of tokens off of this one spell. It's modal, where you can fit it anywhere on the curve, and it's going to be excellent. Great top deck late. It's great in your opening hand. It's just a super powerful card in a really nice color. Green is one of my favorite colors in this format, and it can do a lot of splashing really easily, so we don't even necessarily need to be green-blue. We just kind of need to be green, so really excellent way to start the draft. Pick two here, we have tons of options. To start off, there's Monstrous Rage if we want to go very aggressive, try to push towards green-red. It's an excellent combat trick. If we want to go really splashy, there's a Charade of Numbing Depths here, a great tempo play, stunning something, drawing you a card. If we really want to go for a super synergy-driven deck and try to draft a ton of roll tokens and auras, we could draft the Tanglespan Lookout. It's one of the most narrow picks here, but potentially one of the strongest. Or if we want to just keep it nice and simple and stick to our Goose Mother, we can take the best blue card into the Fey Court for excellent card draw, or the best green card, Curse of the Werefox, for a pretty medium removal spell. I think I'm going to keep it simple here. I do think that Into the Fey Court is better in general at what it's doing than Curse of the Werefox by quite a lot, so we'll start with Into the Fey Court, just sticking to the Goose Mother for now. Pick 3 now is a little awkward for us. I don't really like the blue card at all. The Merfolk Coralsmith is incredibly filler. And Curse of the Werefox, once again, very medium removal. I tend to not like green removal spells very much because they can get 2-for-1 pretty easily by any instant speed interaction from your opponent. If they bounce your creature in response, if they destroy your creature in response, anything like that, they completely counter your removal spell and interact with your creature on board, and you fall very behind from there. There are some decent white removal spells with Cooped Up and the Princess Takes Flight, or just some decent black kind of go wide cards like Lord Skitter's Butcher, Creature and Rat, or you can sacrifice one of your rats to scry to draw a card, or Voracious Foeman, which is just a creature and a rat as well. I think we're going to go for one of the white removal spells here. Some kind of Bance controlling splashy deck makes a lot of sense to me over something that's trying to go wide, really. I think green-black could absolutely make sense here, but it would be more of the food token direction than the rat token direction, trying to get a lot of those food tokens to buy us some time and slow things down. So these aren't really the kind of cards I would love if we were green-black-blue. So let's grab one of the removal spells. I'm going to go for the Princess Takes Flight here. There's definitely a lower floor on this card if you don't get any interaction to go with it, any kind of bargain that lets you sacrifice this enchantment, or any stockpiling celebrants that lets you return it to your hand, then it will be worse than Cooped Up. But the ceiling is much higher. When you do find the bargain cards to work with it, it becomes just a much better version of the Cooped Up. So it takes a little work, but I think generally you can get there in this format. There's plenty of bargain, as well as a common that lets you put it back in your hand and recast it and exile 2 things off the one spell. So we'll take the Princess Takes Flight here. And speaking of bargain, now there's a Hatching Plan, so we could start heading into blue-white, taking a bunch of cards that really want to be sacrificed, and a bunch of bargain cards like Diminisher Witch that give us ways to sacrifice those cards. Then things are a tiny bit awkward with the Goose Mother, where we're splashing in the green instead of the other way around. It's easier to splash when you're in green as a main color because green has mana fixing galore, but there are some pieces of colorless mana fixing in the format that we could use to help splash in the Goose Mother as a blue-white bargain kind of deck at the core, and I think that's probably the strongest direction ahead when we see the incredibly powerful Hatching Plans. Pick 5 now, we see the very solid Hopeless Nightmare. This is for black-based bargain decks. It's quite a nice card. Vermin's pretty decent as well, but Diminisher Witch is kind of the perfect synergy piece to coincide with our Princess Takes Flight and our Hatching Plans, so we will scoop that up. Oh boy, pick six is actually very difficult because I'm a big fan of most of these blue and white spells. There's also great stuff out of black with a Hopeless Nightmare again. Barrow Naughty's great in blue black. Red Cap Thief is quite a solid red common as well. It's just a really loaded pack. But three cards that'd be really excellent in our deck. Tenacious Tomeseeker is going to give us another great way to bargain and sacrifice one of our permanents. The Hopeful Vigil is a card that gives us another great piece of bargain fodder where we can sacrifice this enchantment, get our scry to. It's also another card that works incredibly well with the Stockpiling Celebrant, a common in this format that lets us pick up one of our permanents. Then we'd have both the Hopeful Vigil and the Princess Takes Flight to be able to potentially pick up and get a huge two for one off of that card. So that's a really exciting way to go. There's also a Spell Stutter here, which is a very solid counter spell, even if you don't have a lot of fairies. It's perfectly fine in this format for more controlling decks, and blue white certainly is a very controlling deck in this format. So I think I'm just gonna go with the Tomeseeker. I'm gonna really make sure I've got the critical mass of bargain cards that I need to make sure that the hatching plans and Princess Takes Flight are very consistent. But these other two cards I do really want to shout out as also being excellent, while Transmuter is still quite decent as well. Not a ton here now for pick seven. We'll just take another way to bargain things away with the Archon's Glory. We could also try to go for the Griffinary. If you can get a lot of food token production, every time you're sacking a clue, you're getting a 2-2 flyer now, which is a really big deal. But that could be a little difficult for us in blue-white specifically. Blue-green splash the white, I guess, would make some sense for this, because green can give us a lot of food tokens, but that still seems pretty narrow. I'll just take an Archon's Glory, get another way to sacrifice something, and here we go. Pick number eight, we kind of see the perfect common that I've been talking about. The Stockpiling Celebrant is an excellent combo with our Princess Takes Flight, and if we manage to get any Hopeful Vigils later on, that's going to give us more excellent ways to use this. We could also pick up our Diminisher Witch or our Tenacious Tomeseeker. If we need to bargain something away again, then we can replay them the turn after and get our bargain going. I think there's a lot of great ways to use Celebrant in this deck. Alternatively, though, we're only two cards deep into white, so we could just take Return for the Wilds and try to stick to just blue-green bargain stuff for now. But I think I really like the blue-white little synergy-driven direction we're heading in right now. Pick 9 is going to be pretty filler, whatever we take, a filler creature with Twin Veil Guide or a filler creature with Sleight of Hand. Alternatively, the Break the Spell is another way to use your hatching plans, but I do prefer just having a lot of bargain cards that are doing stuff when we don't have a hatching plans on board as well. Whereas this is basically only going to do something when we do have hatching plans on board, so I'll just take a Sleight of Hand. A pick 10, Kellen's Lightblades is perfect for this kind of blue-white control deck. Great defensive removal spell that lets us bargain away our Princess Takes Flight or our hatching plans. One of the things you want to keep in mind when drafting blue-white in this format is that while it is marketed as the blue-white tap deck, a lot of the tap payoffs and the tap cards are just way too slow and don't play super well, like Frostbridge Guard and stuff. So it is kind of just better to be in this blue-white bargaining controlling version of the deck. So kind of excited to show this sort of archetype off, because I don't think I've really drafted this very much at all in this set. And it is one of the weaker color pairs, so it does take some really, really good reasons to end up in it. And I think we're kind of there, so this could be exciting. Pick 12, I don't think we'll be playing any of these cards. I guess I'll take Plunge into Winter just in case I get really, really good blue-white tap payoffs. But again, generally that's not the way to go. Scarecrow Guide might actually get run in here just to help fix our mana to cast the Goose Mother. Pack 2, pick 1 is kind of a big bummer for us. There's nothing pick-1-able out of blue or white. Even in green, there's nothing super impressive, the best card being Hollow Scavenger, but that's not going to be good on the splash if green is not our main color. Best card in blue or white is probably the Vantress Transmuter, giving us a Kerstral and a 3-4 blocker. Gadwick's First Duel is interesting. You get a Kerstral, then you get to try to duplicate an instant or sorcery later, but we don't really have anything good to duplicate with it right now. Three mana or less instant or sorcery. We've got one copy of Sleight of Hands, one Kellen's Lightblades. be really hard to cast a Kellen's Light Blades during the turn that this trigger goes off. That doesn't seem possible. I guess Archon's Glory. Yeah, I don't think First Duel's going to be great here. I could just rare draft Lord Skitter and then have another option to splash in. It's just a really powerful card if it ends up working. This is enough better than Transmuter that I guess I will grab Lord Skitter. Pretty unlikely we're splashing around with that, but we'll give it a chance. Pack 2, pick 2. I'm very happy to take another Princess Takes Flight when we're grabbing a bunch of ways to bargain it away, and especially because we also have Stockpiling Celebrant, which is the most busted way to use this, turning it into multiple removal spells. So we'll take this, and if we're really lucky, we get this Stockpiling Celebrant back to us. Pack 2, pick 3. There's an on-color Mythic Rare, but it doesn't even do anything. It's a 3-mana 2/4 Vigilance, which is somewhat undercosted, but it's just really not actually doing anything. It's not that impressive. I think I would rather take another way to bargain, like Johann's Stopgap or Diminisher Witch, both of which are certainly better for a slower, more controlling deck like this than Archon's Glory as a combat trick would be here. I think I'll take the Stopgap here, get some variety in our bargain enablers. Don't just have all creatures like Diminisher Witch and Tome Seeker. We need some instants and sorceries to end up in the graveyard for the Tome Seeker. Pick 4, because we have the Stockpiling Celebrant and a bunch of ways to bargain, I am going to take Hopeful Vigil here over the Baluna's Gatekeeper, but I really like Baluna's Gatekeeper in more controlling blue decks because they're giving you a way to slow your opponent down in early game and a late game finisher all in one. It's a pretty high pickup as well. It's very close here between that and the Vigil, but I will take the Vigil. Pick 5, we'll grab another Light Blades and be pretty happy with this, kind of the perfect removal spell for this archetype. Most other archetypes in white are pretty aggressive and actually aren't that big of a fan of Kellen's Light Blades, but this blue-white archetype with enough things to bargain away is where you are very happy with the card. Pick 7, keep going for some late game card advantage with Into the Fey Court here. Already got 2 Princess Takes Flight and 2 Kellen's Light Blades. I don't need the very mediocre removal of Stroke of Midnight. That spell being mediocre because you're giving your opponent something back when you use it, which you really don't want to do. Again, being a more controlling deck here, we take the counterspell over the Fairy Advisor. Pick 9, I'm really not going to be excited about any of this stuff. Do we need more 2-drop creatures? I've got Vigil, Alchemist, Scarecrow Guide. We've got 3 2-mana creatures, 2 2-mana removal spells with 2 Light Blades. I don't think I need more early game bad enough to run something really filler like Frostbridge Guard. Really don't think I'll play Coral Smith or Duel either, and we're definitely not a cheeky House Mouse deck. Guess I'll take the First Duel, but I'd rather not end up having to use that. Pick 10, these are all quite filler, cheap creatures. That isn't what our deck is interested in, so I'll go ahead and take a Brave the Wilds for fixing from the green direction if something incredibly weird happens. And green somehow flips into a core color. Super happy to see this pick 11 Diminisher Witch. Absolutely join the party. Pick 12, I guess we're taking another Scarecrow Guide for more ways to get the Goose Mother cast here. The Solitary Sanctuary, again, is a bit of a trap. It's one of the weakest enablers for the blue-white tapper deck, and we haven't really drafted any of the tap cards because they are kind of inefficient, kind of weak, as well as this kind of this payoff for that deck, I should say. Charade's like the only one that's actually pretty good. Now we do have one Frostbridge Guard if we had taken that Solitary thing, but again, I like picking up that fixing. Alright, pack 3, pick 1, we get a second copy of Hatching Plans that we're super excited about because we have plenty of bargain for it, so that'll be awesome. Pack 3, pick 2, we can just keep bargaining with our Tome Seekers to pick up our Light Blades to keep killing everything. Tons of card advantage in this deck, tons of 2-for-1s, it's gonna be a sweet one. Pick 3 now, and Ice Out is another way to bargain, but if we check our bargain count and it's decent enough here, I'll actually take a Gatekeeper, so we have a little bit more when it comes to actual big creatures for ending the game. And that'll still also give us early interaction at the same time. So for Bargain, we have two Light Blades. We have three Diminisher Witch, two Tome Seeker, one Stopgap, one Archon's Glory. We're at 9 ways to bargain. And my apologies about that Steam ping. That was me. A download just finished up. All right, so 9 ways to bargain already. I don't think we need Ice Out that bad, but it is kind of perfect because it's also a counter spell. Do we just cross our fingers that Gatekeeper comes back, or do we cross our fingers that Ice Out comes back? I mean, either of them is reasonable as something to come back if blue is not very heavily drafted in this pod. I'll take the Ice Out. We'll just be blue-white control with no real win conditions. That's not true. We have a gigantic Goose Mother. We have plenty of 3-2s. If we can deal with everything our opponent's doing, we can jam in with those. So I'll take the Ice Out. Pick 4, Prophetic Prism is perfect. This is a better way for this more controlling kind of deck to mana fix than the Scarecrow Guide, because Scarecrow Guide, pretty weak to removal. Plenty of 1 damage or -1/-1 removal in the format. So we'll take the Prism. Pretty happy to take another Prism here. We could take Quick Study, but we're doing great on card advantage. We have 2 into the Fey Court. We have 2 hatching plans. We have Tome Seekers picking stuff out of grave. We have Stopgap drawing us 1 card. We don't really need the draw 2 here, so we'll take another Prism here. More excited about that. Now we just cut the Scarecrows. Pack 3, pick 6. Hey, guess who's back? It's Tome Seeker number 3. Join the party. Pick number 7 now. Basically nothing. Some really filler creatures we don't have any synergies for. But I guess we're sacrificing hatching plans. We're maybe sacrificing a Princess Takes Flight. So it's a tiny bit of synergy, but still a very slow card. And then Besotted Knight also just super slow. These instants don't do much of anything. I guess I'll take the Knight of Doves, but I'm not going to be starting that in the deck. Ooh, a pick 8 Ice Out. Rather have 1 Ice Out and 1 Gatekeeper than 2 Ice Outs. But if we do wheel the Gatekeeper, then this worked out super well. We didn't wheel the Gatekeeper. I think, because I think it was in pack 1. Maybe it was pack 2 and I'm misremembering here. Could take another Archon's Glory, but I actually think I'm going to cut the first one. Now that we have so many ways to bargain that don't have to involve combat like that. Yeah, I think we have better, more consistent ways to bargain. I'll take another Sleight of Hand. And the reason is that we have 3 Tome Seekers, so we really need to make sure we have instants and sorceries in our grave early, which is slightly difficult when they're all reactive. Right? Like, I'm not going to have a Light Blades in my grave until I've killed an attacking creature, until my opponent has done something. I'm not going to have a Spell Stutter or an Ice Out in grave until my opponent's tried to cast a spell later in the game. So running out turn 3 Tome Seeker to bargain away hatching plans is not going to be the most consistent plan. Because obviously turn 2 I cast the Hatching Plans, turn 3 I cast the Tome Seeker. But one way to do that is turn 1 Sleight of Hand, turn 2 Hatching Plans, turn 3 Tome Seeker. That is actually the perfect curve, because then I have the instant sorcery in grave, I have the Hatching Plans on board, and I get the bargain going. So Sleight of Hand actually seems pretty decent for that little combo. Pick 10, we get another Diminisher Witch, which I'm pretty happy with. Again, we have so much card draw, we don't need Quick Studies. Now we'll take a Moment of Valor, which isn't actually unplayable removal, but with so many counter spells, a couple Light Blades, a couple Princess Takes Flight, I don't think we need it. Aquatic Alchemist, I'm probably cutting the first at this point, and I might run 1 Quick Study. I think it's much more likely than running 1 Besotted Knight. And a third Sleight of Hand. All right, well, we'll run all 3, and we can cut a land or 2 for those if we have enough islands in the deck. Because then we dig through the top 2 and we just put the land into our hand anyway. Just cycle it into a land much like you would in Evolving Wilds or a Terramorphic Expanse. So I think I can cut 2 lands for 3 Sleight of Hands. I think that's a fair trade out there. Go 8-6-1 here. Keep that island count really high so that we can cast the Sleight of Hands with them and search for the plains or the forests. And the Prophetic Prisms are going to be very helpful. So those are absolutely sticking in. We just need to cut 5 cards. I'll put the Tome Seekers up here, because they're usually going to take a little longer than the Diminisher Witches. Hopeful Vigil goes up here with the creatures. I'm still not loving that Gadwick's First Duel. I suppose now we have 3 Sleight of Hands as our best way to double something up with the copy something mana value 3 or less. But it obviously doesn't work with our counter spells. It doesn't work very well with Kellen's Light Blades. It's still not particularly consistent. And if it's just going to be a Cursed Roll and a Scry 2, it's not super worth the cost. So I think we are ditching that. Frostbridge Guard's the most filler creature. We can probably ditch that. Again, it leaves us with not a lot of early game, but we're trying to get a lot of mileage out of the Light Blades, Princess Takes Flight. Just cast those early and slow our opponents down. Just rip those out of here. 3 more cuts to go. Again, all the other card advantage. I suppose we can get the Quick Study out of here. Although the one thing I do like about it is good with the counter spells, giving us something instant speed if they don't cast a spell. Still think it is probably the cut before anything else here. You know, honestly, with double hatching plans, maybe we can drop one into the Fey Court. And then also with our bargain count, we might be able to drop one creature, like 4 Diminisher, which might be slightly high. Maybe we can drop one of those. So drop a 1/1 here, still have 3 copies of Witch, 1 copy of Into the Fey Court. Seems okay. For bargain, it's still going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 ways to do so. We've got a Celebrant to pick up a Princess Takes Flight, so it's another way to synergize with this, but not with hatching plans. I think that is fine. Alternatively, with 2 Ice Outs, though, maybe cut a Spell Stutter, since these are just straight better in this deck for the most part. Spell Stutter is definitely easier to cast because we are 3 color. We're only on 15 lands because of the triple sleight of hand. But the Ice Out is just counter it, period, and it is essentially the same mana cost, 2 mana. It's just double blue that'll make it difficult. But that bargain synergy is just pretty big upside pretty often. I think I am going to actually drop a Spell Stutter if we've got the 2 Ice Out still anyway. And then we could just cut 1 Diminisher, which still have double Into the Fey Court for great top end. And I think that I am happy to call it a deck here. Alright, here's a look at the final deck list for today. We're on a blue-white bargain control deck. It's a pretty wild archetype. It is the most controlling in the format. That does have a lot of pretty aggressive and rampy things going on. This deck is planning on getting a ton of value by sacrificing enchantments like Hatching Plans to draw 3 cards, sacrifice enchantments like the Princess Takes Flight so that they won't give your opponent their creature back, and while you're doing that, anything you're sacrificing these to is just getting extra value, where you want to sacrifice these cards for their abilities, but you also want to sacrifice these for the bargain abilities, where because you've sacrificed your enchantment, you get to turn one of your opponent's creatures into a 1/1, or because you've sacrificed your enchantment, you get to return an instant or sorcery from your graveyard to your hand. So really cool synergies with the whole blue-white bargain kind of control deck. We've also got Stockpiling Celebrant, which is a great combo with the Princess Takes Flight, letting us exile an additional creature with it. And we've got a bunch of general control tools. We're going to be winning the long game by getting way ahead in card advantage with multiple draw 3s in this deck between Into the Fey Court and Hatching Plans, multiple 2-for-1s making sure we can be loaded up with removals and counterspells like all these Tome Seekers that pick up our expended removal or our expended counterspells from our graveyard. We've got Fixing with some Prophetic Prisms, as well as a ton of card draw to make sure that we draw into one of our 3 green sources so that we have our 1 really big bomb rare finisher, the Goose Mother, at the top end. So, gonna be a pretty sweet deck today, probably a lot of long, grindy games, but hopefully they end in our favor. But I suppose we'll find out soon enough as we head into the gameplay. Here we are for game 1. This opening hand is pretty awkward mana-wise, and we're not doing anything till turn 3. I think I take the mulligan on this one. Okay, this hand is much better. Even though it's mono-colored, it is the most important color for all these cards, which is good. and the prism can get us wherever we need to go. Hatching plans into Diminisher Witch is definitely the plan. So I suppose we get rid of Stopgap. Don't think we can get rid of Sleight of Hand, because if I don't naturally draw my third land, I really need Sleight of Hand to solve that for me and just pick it up. And there we go. So we're going to hold off on Prophetic Prism here so we can just turn three crack a Hatching Plans. Although right now, Boros Aggro, one of the most aggressive decks in this format, really awkward matchup for one of the slowest decks in the format. But hopefully they play some bigger than a 1-1 this turn, and they do, so I can Diminisher Witch the Thief down to 1-1 stats, get my draw 3. Then there's another Diminisher Witch, which if nothing else, if they play a creature bigger than the Red Cap Thief, I can bargain away the cursed roll that's on the Thief to put a cursed roll onto something bigger. And now we have a Princess Takes Flight to bargain away, so that's kind of perfect. Although I don't have the mana for that yet. I will need to get my Prism down. Ooh, this is quite a curve from our opponent. Haste creature turn 1, haste creature turn 2. A creature turn 3 into a creature and a removal spell turn 4. Alright, white source for the Princess Takes Flight goes a long way here. Will it go far enough, though? Because we're still taking 3 a turn. And we don't have life gain until we get the Goose Mother down. But the Goose Mother is definitely our out here. Uh-oh, they got something that buffs the whole board. Yeah, the Gnawing Crescendo for 9 damage. Yikes. There's the Stockpiling Celebrant to go with the Princess Takes Flight instead of the Diminisher Witch. Yeah, with nothing to put the Cursed Roll onto, that feels like the better play for the turn. But there's a lot of cards that could kill me this turn, they just need to have another removal spell. If they don't, though, this is where we take over. There's the Ice Out, but I have nothing to bargain away for it, so that's not going to save us anyway. Still like having it for the future so they can't top deck something that kills us. But I have to Prism this turn, and we're dead to them having another removal spell, but if they do, they just had a great hand, and that's that. It's one turn from deciding who wins this game. If they kill us now, obviously we're dead. If they don't, pretty sure we win from here. Combat tricks work as well. Okay, Light Blades is the removal. Which does still sort of mean we're dead, right? Because we really needed the block to go through, even though I didn't die that turn. If it was removal that would have killed the blocker pre-combat, we would have died then. I still kind of die because now they have 3 attackers. Or sorry, 4 attackers instead of just 3. I can get a food from Goose Mother for 3 mana. 2 mana to eat it, I go to 4 life. I can block the Bivouac, take 3. Oh boy. I need to hold 2 mana up here, so I can Goose Mother where X equals 2, spending 4 mana on it. That's still just 1 food anyway. Oh, it can put a +1/+1 on any of their creatures? Yeah, then we're still dead. Yeah, removal spell plus another creature that turn is the kill. If they only had one or the other, we might have still been in here. Don't think one Princess Takes Flight and one Diminisher Witch is enough. Yeah, no, because then we just one thing gets in and we're dead. Yep, we're dead. Alright. Actually way closer than it looked. Because obviously we have more than enough cards to kill everything they play from here on out. We just don't have the time to spend all the mana it takes to deal with everything. So if they do this right, we're dead. If they bivouac the counter onto anything other than the bivouac. But if they do it wrong, we're still around. Alright, they did it right. GG, just an insane curve from one of the most aggressive decks in the format. And even then, we were only like one turn from stabilizing pretty hard. Rough. Here we are for game two. Our nine islands are running for their life, and we gotta take a mulligan. We will keep the second hand here. We've got hatching plans with a prophetic prism to light blades it up. Think I can, yeah, I can still bargain away hatching plans to a tome seeker if there isn't an instant or sorcery in my grave. It just isn't as good. But bargain is when you cast the spell, so it doesn't need to have a target to be able to use the bargain. Oh, that's actually perfect. It's actually perfect if we hit a land. There we go. Sorry, hatching plans, copy two. We'll only hatch one plan today. Playing against green-white. They're on the play. The turn one creature. I'm just play all the islands for now. There's only one blue card in this deck. Or sorry, only one green card in this deck. So we'll just make sure that we've got all the blue sources we need to cast two or three blue spells in one turn later if we need to. Or if we need double blue up for an ice out. All that kind of stuff. Alright, well, our opponent is on the play here, but luckily for us, they had a much less aggressive start, so we've got plenty of time to just get way ahead here. Pick up the ice out, ditch a land probably to hand size. I guess a double prism is redundant, although we can still sack the prisms to bargain. Yeah, I'm going to get rid of a land here. We're going to do a lot of card draw. We'll probably be able to always have like one land in hand throughout this game. So let's sleight of hand into some non-land action. Sure, Diminisher Witch is good enough. Let's get another blue source down. Got a single keep card with no enchantments on board, so it can't get plus one, plus one. So currently, our single 3-2 is winning the game. So, I'll send it in. Alright, trading for light blades is perfectly fine by me. Then I'll just hold up ice out here. We just play our controlling role from here on out. We got plenty of time to get a full grip of seven cards and then chill. Alright, there's the natural white source. That's pretty nice. So let's drop a prism. I should have played my land first, just in case they had an instant I really need to counter. Because then they could cast something while the prism's still on the stack and I couldn't ice out. Alright, again, we're on a control deck. It's going to be a long game, but I'm fairly confident right now. Next turn is when we get to drop a 3-2 and hold up the counterspell or the light blades for removal. Because I've drawn all of the colors of mana that I actually need here, is destroy, right? Yeah, light blades destroy, so I don't need to ice out. Okay, never mind. I was going to say, because I've drawn all the colors I need here, I can bargain away this prophetic prism for tome seeker value, but since I drew a hopeful vigil, I do want the prisms for to be able to cast two white spells in one turn. Alright, so now we're going to light blades the vanguard, sacking hopeful vigil, getting a scry, then next turn we can got a lot of auras, that could be a big problem. I can't really take a vanguard turn though. I'd take a vanguard hit for a turn. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't have cast the second prism, so I could have went ice out plus light blades. Completely lost my train of thought now, trying to not die to a vanguard. Oh yeah, I'm gonna Tome Seeker back my removal. That was my train of thought. Grab another ice out. Use these very, very freely. But the Season of Growths mean when they cast their spells, even if they don't resolve, they are drawing cards off of their auras and their combat tricks and stuff like that. I'll get there eventually. The brain do work sometimes. Alright, so we're holding up light blades or one ice out. Could trade Keep Guard into our 2-2 if they spend the mana. That's fine by me. Could be much bigger later. I'm not going to light blades the Keep Guard. We take those trades. It's going to gain them some life, that's fine. I'll just light blades it. I think I'm only really countering things that I won't be able to just deal with light blades. Although we are at the point now that I will have to sack my prism and only play one white spell a turn. Ooh. Doesn't actually do anything right now, does it? Yeah, not currently. But we've got two Princess Takes Flights to draw into. That would be really good. Actually, just gonna make this a 1-1. They're down to two cards in hand. We still have basically infinite. All right, we can counter that. No bargain. Keep the cursed roll on the board. Could also let it happen because they might not have a way to bargain it. But bargain is also a cost to casting a spell, so I can't counter them from bargaining and sacrificing the Princess Takes Flight. Alright, Into the Fey Court's incredible here, because it gives me bargain fodder for the ice out. Even if I don't draw land off of it, I can sacrifice the fairy. And I did draw land, so I can just cast ice out full on. Yeah, our opponent is out of this game and they know it. We just have the game fully on lock, fully controlled, as you do in blue-white control. So pretty different stuff today. I don't do hard control decks very often because they're not very good in draft very often. But here we are. We are now 1-1 heading into game number 3. Here we are for game 3, the unkeepable opener. We need the island to go with the sleight of hand to turn it into a land. That's why we are on the 9 island. But it hasn't looked like it. I think we've mulliganed every game. This is the keep, and we ditch an island, treating sleight of hand as the third land, hoping it can find a plains or get closer to a plains. Perfect. Uh-oh, another red deck, really aggressive color. At least we have the light blades early this time. Princess Takes Flight Tomeseeker is going to be a really good couple turns. Oh, it's blue-red, which is going to be more controlling and slow. Which sounds actually a little weaker against, because it doesn't have any card draw, which is what you really want in the grindier matchups. Yeah, they're blue-red-green ramp. Yeah, we really want the card draw here. Oh, they're full four color, and all we got is lands. This is not looking great. Actually, counterspell would be really important for this as well, potentially. Okay, there's a ruby for mana. She gets bigger when they've got creature with power 4 or greater as well. Attacks as a 3-4 instead of a 1-2. Yeah, it's just going to be a super wide board state against a bunch of 1-for-1 removal. This could be a really big problem. Okay, Vigil's nice. Give us something to bargain away for the light blades. Scry while we're at it. if they end up sending something in with more than 3 toughness. Hamlet Glutton. I don't have the counter spell, so we're going to Light Blades that for this scry. I could also Princess Takes Flight it. I could also just sack the Vigil for the scry, but oh my god. Tough Cookie is super, super bad. I might have to Princess Takes Flight the Tough Cookie then. So Princess Takes Flight Tough Cookie so they can't just beat us down with their food tokens. Then we Kellen's Light Blades the Glutton, sacrificing the Princess Takes Flight. I kind of don't want to sacrifice Vigil, that way I can Tome Seeker, sacrifice Vigil, pick up Light Blades, or Sleight of Hand or something. Yeah, we know our plan for the next 2 turns, even if I draw nothing, which I did. So we don't need to scry right now. Okay, so shut off the Tough Cookie, essentially shutting off a 2-2 and a 4-4, which is a very big deal. And that's really good too. Bunch of counters on to the 1-1, make it a 4-4. No attacks with the Glutton playing around the Light Blades. Well, very lucky to have a Tome Seeker here. Well, we kill the 4-4 human, right? Ruby does give them mana, but hitting one harder every turn's a big deal. Kind of want to scry right now, but then I have to have Tome Seeker resolve, and they have a blue mana up. It'd be really weird to see a counterspell there, but I don't know exactly what their deck's doing here, so I'm going to play it safe. And just make sure that the Tough Cookie's gone forever. Hatching plans if they have some bargain. There's into the Fey Court. A little bit late here. We can't afford to cast it right now because I need a Light Blades in hand for the Glutton immediately. So Tome Seeker back the Light Blades, sacking the Vigil. Find Ice Out Goose Mother. I need a green source. So keep Goose Mother, ditch Ice Out to get closer to Prophetic Prism or something. I could also keep the Ice Out. I'm going to into the Fey Court next turn no matter what. I think I'm just going to go all in on hitting green for Goose Mother here to flip this game around. Get closer to it there. So now the play is they attack with both creatures. I chump the 3-4 with a 2-2 and then sacrifice the 2-2 to Light Blades the Glutton. They attack with just one, we just double block with Light Blades up if weird stuff happens. And if nothing happens here, they're just going to kill the token so that I have nothing to bargain for the Light Blades next turn. So they think I'll have a fairy. Ooh, they had to flick a coin too. That is really nice in that interaction. Okay, so we Fey Court. That gives us the token to bargain for Light Blades to kill the Glutton. Picnic Ruiner will still hit us for 4. It'll get its double strike swing. There's the green source for the Goose Mother. I'll play that next turn. I'm going to play the island now, threatening a counterspell until I Light Blades, which 100% is going to happen here. But I can't Light Blades till Glutton declares the attack, and when it declares the attack, the Picnic Ruiner gets the double strike. So, I can't stop the 4 damage from Picnic Ruiner here, sadly. And they might even just attack with Picnic Ruiner. In which case, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do. Probably still Light Blades. Oh my god, definitely if they put that on it. That means both creatures are threatening 6 damage. Yeah, and a 1-1 that can only block flyers is not that valuable. So I am going to bargain it away just in case they have another combat trick. Because if they have another combat trick, I'm straight up dead. If I try to deal 3 to this and then they give it +2/+1 with the minecart daredevil or something. The princess takes flight. 4 damage on their board here. So if I tap out for Goose Mother, it's going to be a 9-9 and I have a bunch of food, but then I take 10 if they just kill it. Draw cards, cast the princess takes flight. Doesn't seem terrible. I take 4 on board. Okay, none of that is the bargain for the princess takes flight, but worst case scenario, this still slows down the glutton for a few turns. We're still kind of locked in on going for it here. Take my 4. I'm at 12. There's another glutton sacking a hatching plans, drawing 3. Welcome to Sweet Tooth. It's a sleight of hand. Find the bargain. It does find the bargain. Or the Celebrant is actually even better. Celebrant is a massive deal here. Keep the sleight of hand, I think. It was so much mana, we can spend the one on the sleight of hand to dig a little farther. Could even do it this turn. And still have Princess Takes Flight mana. Yeah, I can Prism, sleight of hand. Princess Takes Flight. Okay, well, these don't matter. They're welcome to Sweet Tooth, still looking really good here. That's 2 4/4s on their board after that triggers. The cut-in. I don't know what their deck is. It's just all the best cards. They just drafted the best card in every pack, regardless of color, and then went for it. Kind of what it looks like. Everything in their deck is like a really high pick, except Return from the Wilds. So it's just best card by games in hand win rate out of every pack, and 4 copies of Return from the Wilds. It's the full all-color deck. Yeah, I mean, we've got the Goose Mother, but I think it is too late. I think our opener was just way too slow for this kind of matchup. And if I Goose Mother now, I can't bargain away the Princess Takes Flight and they're going to get a glutton back. I guess I can still do a Goose Mother for less and bargain this turn. Because I need the blocker. I get 8/8 here if I do that. If I do this, I still get 2 food and it's a 6/6. How much food do they have? +1/+1. X is 1 plus the number of foods you control, so +3/+3. They can make a 5/5, but I'll have a 6/6. Yeah, I guess we make this 6/6 then, so I can eat a food and be slightly less likely to die immediately. But I don't think it's enough here. Like, we're at the point now that in order to win this game, we need to have like an 80 card deck because I'm gonna have to dig so far, I'm gonna mill myself even if I do stabilize. Another picnic ruiner? Sure is, jeez. God, this was an incredible matchup for counter spells, but we only saw one, and we kind of had to put it on bottom. The counter spells play really good against adventure creatures. And 2-for-1 cards like Welcome to Sweet Tooth and stuff. But the hard removal is so much weaker here. I guess we are only running the two now, right? Just the ice outs. Guess I should have talked about counter spells earlier. That is strange. The second I talk about how good counter spells would be in the matchup, it's like, here you go. We got your back. Here we are. Yeah, that's worth the counter. It's a lot. Tome Seeker's huge. Four damage on board. I have to eat a food. Stopgap's actually potentially even bigger than Tome Seeker, being able to bounce the 2/2, just permanently kill it and draw a card. The draw a card part's actually awkward down to 9, and we know what our bottom cards are. Oh no. There's three cards that matter, and then we're gonna hit a little land clump. Yeah, I think we're gonna mill out here. I mean, we'll see. All right, well, I gotta kill the 2/2 for sure. And we can have three twos to block the Picnic Ruiner, and we can pick up Light Blades and just have infinite Light Blade style removal. Don't need the green source at all, so let's Tome Seeker up a Light Blades. It's gonna be a real close one. A real close one. Maybe because I do have the one Light Blades in hand, I should have just picked up the counter spell here. I still can Light Blades the Picnic Ruiner, counter spell something worse. Yeah, because I have double Tome Seeker, that's probably better. Green Puff. Okay. I will have to bargain away the fairy or the food on that. Yikes. I don't want to bargain that. Oh, it really is going to be too slow. Is there anything I can pick up with Tome Seeker that gives me like a bunch of bargain fodder? I think the only thing that gives me bargain fodder also draws me three, which is an issue. Yeah, the Into the Fey Court. It's the only instant or sorcery that I can pick up to get something to bargain with. I'm gonna pick up the ice out. I should have done this the other way around, because now they could actually... They could use a removal spell on the fairy to get rid of my only bargain fodder, so that I can't light blades the scream puff with one copy. And that would obviously be very bad. It's harder for them to interact with a food token. Yeah, see, if I had sacked the fairy, then I could just, like, let this resolve and that'd be fine. But now, since they can fight the fairy so I can't crack the fairy to light blades, it is pretty bad for me. So I have to spend two light blades or two ice outs at this point. Or sorry, two light blades or an ice out and a light blades. I have to spend two spells either way. Oh, they have the hexproof trick? Ooh, not dead after all, and I don't have the bargain fodder to do another light blades. I guess I could have played hatching plans. Thought I wouldn't have had the mana up if I did anyway. Okay. That is bad. Sure don't want to mill out, but I sure do need bargain fodder. So let's actually do this. Diminish your witch into another ice out. We're in party mode now. Whatever. It's party time. Time to mill out. You still have spells. I've drawn so many cards and you're still keeping up. If I lose like a single 3-2 without doing anything with it, then I'm not going to have the damage output to potentially kill them before I mill out. I have 3 turns to kill them. Come on, team. Go, team, go. Go, team, go. Six damage a turn, they're at 17. Six next turn, six the turn after that is 12. And I have no more creatures. Yeah, they win. We don't kill them fast enough. So close. I literally predicted this too. I was like, I mean, if we get in a position where we can turn the board in our favor, we're not going to win unless we had like an 80 card deck anyway, because we're just going to end up drawing out. Literally one card from winning. One more turn was lethal. Oh, close. Devastating start for the blue-white control deck, but I mean, it is the lowest win rate archetype in the set. I think this deck is great, though. I am really bummed out right now. I think this is like the strongest kind of version of the blue-white, but not over yet. We're at 1-2, heading into game 4. Here we are on the play for game 4. We have nothing to bargain. We got two mana for all the three drops. Gotta take a mulligan again. This is basically the same hand without the planes now. Actually, it's 2 5 drops this time. Start off with the classic mull to five. And this is genuinely the best hand we've seen out of the openers. It's kind of sad. Not the openers today, just out of the openers this game. Turn one, Snare Master Sprite from our opponent. At this point, we're just locking in the third land. If we see it, we do. Lock in the green source. The sad team. The no bargain bargain cards. Alright, there we go. I was going to be so salty. I was like, is my hard control deck about to get curiosity'd out of the game? Is my deck with more interaction than most of the decks that I've run gonna die to the combo? That is only good if you don't draw interaction. No. Took another turn, but we found the removal. Alright, well, this is where things pop off. Princess Takes Flight, Stalking Celebrant. Stockpiling Celebrant, I should say. You don't really want to be stalking people. Princess Takes Flight, Stockpiling Celebrant. Princess Takes Flight, Tome Seeker. This is our next four turns. Just see how well that goes. It's a plan. We're hitting for five in the sky next turn. The Skewer Slinger, so I guess they could chump block the Flying Diminisher Witch, or they could torch it. Okay, so no extra damage here, but this is still fine. Pick that up. So we want a fifth land to be able to play Vigil and Tome Seeker in the same turn, so we do want the island and then the Vigil. It's a perfectly fine order. We're just going to play Princess Takes Flight next turn. I guess if I go Vigil first, then if they don't play something good to Princess Takes Flight, we can just play Vigil this turn. So you definitely don't play a Tome Seeker before a Vigil. Okay, a 3-2's fine. Or a 2-4 reach that shoots things. Either of those are fine targets. The 2-4 is actually harder for us to deal with because our deck is nothing but 3-2s, so I'll get rid of that. See if we can find our own card draw here. Our opponent's up six cards because they hit a hatching plans into the Fey Court. Two cards we have two copies of in this deck, so realistically we should be able to keep up, but we have not found the tools to do so. Yeah, this is awkward. We remain far behind. We remain six cards behind, to be exact. I guess maybe not quite, because we've Tome Seekered. Jesus Christ. That's Jason Bourne. I mean, these are only stopping 3 damage anyway. Oh no, because they have the mana to cast. This is a 4-4 haste as well. I'd have to bargain away the Knight to be able to go Ice Out and Light Blades here, but I think it is still worth bargaining the Ice Out to have that option of casting both. Because I will have to bargain. There's our draw 3. I'll have to bargain to kill the familiar because it's so high toughness at this point. I mean, I don't know if I have time for that, but still just going to keep it here. Play it, and then there's land for turn to play after we cast it. It's a way to come back. The 1-1 trades into their fairy to stop that damage. Yeah, this seems like what we're doing. Now we have 1-1 fairy to trade with their 1-1 fairy. Oh, they've got a hexproof trick in there. And it's base power, so it just makes it lethal? Okay. Well, I didn't learn all that much today, honestly. That's usually what we want to go back and do. When you lose a draft, you want to look back at things, see what you could have done differently, draft-wise, gameplay-wise. I think I played fine. Obviously didn't play incredibly or anything. There were some loose lines where I could have went for better plays. The ones that I really noticed were in the first couple games of the draft. Last couple just kind of felt pretty unwinnable. But that's just how things are sometimes. Don't think there's a whole lot to learn from this one. Just a pretty rough draft. A lot of mulligans. The one forest showing up so often in our opening hands. The 9 islands not showing enough for the 3 sleight of hands. So maybe that is something we learned. Maybe the whole sleight of hand thing was just wrong and we're just supposed to just do 17 lands. This would be our 17 lands and just not cut the 2 lands to run 3 sleight of hands. We could just run 1 sleight of hand and not try to treat them like Terramorphic Expanse's Evolving Wilds, because if they're in our opening hand without the island, then they don't actually cycle into a land out of the top 2. I think that general plan was still fine. I think the deck itself looks very strong on paper. The double hatching plans, the Into the Fey Courts, to get really ahead in card advantage and then use these removal spells, counter spells, leverage these, loop them back. That kind of thing was decent. The double Princess Takes Flight was good too. With how things played out, I think perfect build here isn't that far off from this, but having like another Light Blades instead of another Diminisher Witch would have been better. So 3 Light Blades, 2 Diminisher Witch, that kind of thing. Just minor little adjustments like that get pretty close to like the perfect kind of build. So yeah, I don't hate how I drafted. I don't hate how I played. I just think this is the weakest archetype in the format, but this is how to build it. generally go for blue-white control instead of blue-white tappers. It just didn't quite pan out for us. There were a couple really close games that could have flipped this from a 1-3 right now to a 3-1 instead. There was the game that we were one turn from lethaling them, but we just ran out of cards in the end. I don't really think we could have prevented that, because if we hadn't bargained away the hatching plans to diminish your witch, then we wouldn't have been swinging anyway. But maybe there was some card draw used earlier in the game that could have been prevented. I don't know, I still think that game was played fine. And then the other was our first loss. We were also like one turn from really stabilizing, but they just had an insanely quick aggressive curve. Our last loss, I think that was not really going to be winnable. I think they just hit a lot more action early. They managed to crack an early hatching plans and cast it into the Fey Court while playing a land every single turn, thanks to drawing an extra six cards. So they're playing a land every turn. They're dumping their hand out every turn because they have so much action. We just didn't have an early hatching plans or into the Fey Court. We had one into the Fey Court at the time when we were already dead anyway. So just they out card drawed us there pretty hard. So yeah, I don't know. I think the deck's good. I think things just really didn't line up for us today, which is pretty sad, but it is also part of the format, part of this kind of deck. It is weak to really aggressive decks. There are some really aggressive decks in this format, as we saw from red-white, and it is the kind of deck you need to draw the right cards at the right time. You really want to hit these hatching plans before you hit your bargain cards. You really don't want to hit your bargain cards without the bargain fodder, like Princess Takes Flight or Hatching Plans or Hopeful Vigil, and some of those kind of awkward sort of draws were happening frequently. We mulliganed, I think, every single game as well, so just the lower end of variance for us takes one of the weaker archetypes in the format that can be really cool and I think had a pretty powerful build and just makes it look really, really weak, sadly. So 1-3 it is for today. But that is going to end the Wilds of Eldraine quick drafts this time around, and that is going to end today's video. As always, I'd like to thank my patrons and YouTube members for their support, as well as you for watching the video. If you're interested in seeing some more, you can always like, comment, and subscribe to tell the YouTube algorithm to send you some more in your recommended feed. If you'd like to catch me live, you can check out the Twitch channel in the link in the description below. And if you'd like to support the channel directly, you can check out the Patreon link in the description below. Other than that, as always, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again soon for some more Magic Arena.